Thank you so much for coming. This is actually the 12th year in a row, consecutive year, that we are having a summer school somewhere in Canada. It rotates around Canada. And originally, it was mostly aimed at Canadian and American students, and now we have broadened up wider to everybody around the world to attend the summer school. It's a great achievement for Canadian quantum computing. There are lots of groups around Canada that does quantum computation. And I hope that you are able to see some of the different people here in Canada and around the world that are doing quantum computing and establish some contacts with other fellow students whom you will hopefully have as colleagues later on. So I'm going to continue discussing quantum algorithms, what Martin and John, they talked about in the beginning of this week here. What can you do in terms of computations on a quantum computer? Okay. And I'm going to talk about a specific model. So not sort of the Shor model with factoring, but more the grower type and random walk model, where you talk about queries. So I'm going to talk about queries, but where I want to talk about, you can equate queries with time. And here's a model that we are going, the model of computation we are going to discuss. So here, imagine the following. You have n envelopes, so 1 through n, and I'll call them x1 through xn, each in envelopes. And each one of these envelopes contains a bit. Okay. So we can think of this basically as a bit string of n bits. So in this case here, the first envelope contains a 0, the second envelope contains a 1, and so forth. And then we can ask queries about to an oracle, what's in envelope number I? For instance, if I ask what is in envelope number 3, I'll get a 0 as the answer. So the third envelope contains a 0. Okay, we call this a query. What is in that ith envelope? Okay, we need to model this quantumly. So firstly, you have to remember the input, right? There's no way of forgetting on a quantum computer. Everything is unitary. So in some sense, we have to stick the query around here to try to model this here quantumly. Okay, so that's fine. I mean, whenever you do a query, you get I, you query I, you get I and the bit xi out. Okay. But it also has to be reversible, right? I mean, there's really no time in quantum mechanics. If time could go forward or time could go backwards. So you cannot also just sort of learn information and not be able to forget it again. You should be able to undo this kind of thing here. And this type of query here does not allow for that. So we need a way to model here that we can actually undo queries. And a nice and natural way of doing this is to, here's my query I, and then I also give you a coin, which is faced head up. Okay, so I give you I, and I give you a coin with the head up. Then if the xi bit is 1, then you give me back I and the coin, and you flip it if the bit is 1, and you don't flip it if it's 1. Okay, so if xi is 1, then you flip the coin. If xi is 0, you don't flip the coin. So if you do this twice, if I do this twice here, I'm back to identity. Doing the same thing again undoes what I did. Right? If xi is 1, I ask I, and the coin is being flipped. I ask the same thing again with the same coin I flipped, and then it's being flipped again. I'm back to the original state. So this is reversible now. Okay. And just putting kits around these operators here and say, now we can also ask these questions in superposition here. Then we have a unitary operator. It's a permutation matrix. So this here is how we are going to model queries on a quantum computer. And Martin discussed this too, but this is very important for this talk, so we are going through it again. It's important to get the model right. If you don't have a reasonable model here, everything you study within that model doesn't really make a lot of sense and nobody cares. Okay, so this is the model we are fixing. I'll try this one. Yeah. Okay, a query. And we can query these in superposition. This was very, okay. We define the cost as simply just the number of queries. And as I said, query the main cost of all of the algorithms I'm going to discuss will be in the number of queries. So you can equate time with queries or queries with time. It's the same thing. So you might know that there actually is an alternative model here. You start thinking about it, right? The difference between quantum and classical is really this about the phases, right? You don't just have the computational basis, you also have the phases you can play around with. So one could actually define a query model here where you play with the phases instead. And this is one way of doing it. So one, if I want to know the bit I was in envelope number I get the answer, but I get it in the phases. So instead of flipping a coin, I flip the face. And if I flip the face twice, then I'm back to the original. Okay, if this is 1, then it's minus 1 to the 1, which is minus 1, I flip the face if the envelope contains a 1. Okay, these two models here are actually equivalent. And the proof of that they can simulate each other is very simple. It's just giving explicitly a circuit that does it. And here is a way that you can simulate the orange with the blue. So you can simulate phase with the computational basis oracle as such. This circuit does it. What you do is you simply set up the target register in a 0 minus 1 computational state here, a superposition here, and then query the oracle. And because this is 0 minus 1, if you negate that coin, you get minus 1 plus 1, minus 0 plus 1, which is the negation. And that phase negation trails up to the first state here, and the target qubit stays in the state it was in, and we can undo it to reset it in the initial state. So you can simulate the orange with the blue, and conversely, you can simulate the blue with the orange. So the two oracles are really equivalent. And this here is slightly more complicated, but it is possible to simulate the blue oracle with the orange oracle as sketched here. And this here is a conditional swap operator. Okay, we won't discuss this part here. So these two oracles, we can choose any one of them as we want, depending on what problem we're discussing. It's the same cost. The exact same cost, one to one. Okay, so now we have defined a model. Let's discuss some of the problems that we are going to look at. Okay, so these are some of the problems that people have been studying and we could be interested in. Now, this is a Grover's problem, the negation of Grover's problems. Is it the case that all of the envelopes contains the value 0? Yes or no? Or is it not the case that there is at least one envelope containing a bit 1? So I'm not finding here, I'm just deciding yes or no, right? Afterwards, you can try to find where the 1 is. These are just decision problems, yes or no? Do all the envelopes contain the value 0? Yes or no? Or I can do something in terms of, this here is really binary searching. Or sorting, related to sorting. Is it the case that these bits are sorted? Yes or no? Right? So do I have an initial string starting with zeros and then a suffix here that is all ones? Are these n bits sorted? Or I can count. I can ask how many of these envelopes contains the value 1. Or I can find, this is really Grover's original problem, find an index I that contains where the ith envelope contains a 1. I can ask other problems, for instance, about graphs. Graphs is a big topic within quantum computing. Is it the case that the graph is connected? Or does it contain a triangle, for instance, as a subgraph? Okay. So let's start designing algorithms. And we're actually going to design algorithms now. Okay, so here's the first problem. So we have 4 envelopes in this game now. And one of them contains a 1. That's a promise. Okay, so they're not every possibility. It's kind of like it's hidden somewhere. There's 1, 1, and it's hidden in one of these 4 envelopes. And where is it? Is it in the second envelope, as in this case here? Is it in the third envelope, or is it in one of the other ones? Where is it? Okay, so classically, how many queries will this take here? If I just classically, if this really was normal. So you can ask me. So now I'm thinking about 1. So try to guess it where it is. 1? No, it's not in envelope 1, sorry. 2? No, it's not in envelope 2. 3? No, it's not in envelope 3. Yeah, now you don't want to ask really about the fourth envelope, right? because you already know it because of the promise. So it's really not n, but it's n minus 1. It's 3 instead of 4. You save the very last query. But we found it. I was kind of the adversary which tried to maximize the number of queries you did, so I purposely just said no. I mean. Okay, so there's a sort of a classic randomized version of this algorithm here, namely, if you don't know where, I mean, a priori you have no information about where the one is, right? It could be in any of these four envelopes, so this kind of this randomly, you can just pick an arbitrary envelope and ask, is it in arbitrary random number 2? Is it in envelope number 2? Yes or no? And the quantum analog of that will really just be to set up an equal weighted superposition of all of the envelopes, 1 through 4, and then ask that query. This is not normalized. Yeah, very good. I should maybe address that earlier on. So the type of queries that we will allow is only what is the content of envelope I. We will not allow for queries of the form what is in envelope I or J, or is there one in envelope I or J. That's a computational question. That's not the fundamental units we compare against. We will only allow queries of the form what is in envelope I. That's the only type of question you can ask me. Okay. So this superposition here really corresponds to just classical guessing. This is kind of like the classical randomized version, right? Just ask an arbitrary envelope, and this is unnormalized state. And we stuff this into this oracle, and we get some state out, depending on where the one is. And there are only four possible places where the one can be. It's in envelope number 1, and in that case we flip this one here because we use the phase oracle. So this phase here is being negated. Or the one is in envelope number 2, and then this phase here is being negated, and so forth. We pick up exactly one minus depending on where the unique one is, and it's in one of these four envelopes. So after asking our phase oracle here, asking one question only, we have one of these four states, and we know we have one of these four states. It's not another state we have. Okay. So the question is really, how much information is there in this set of four states? How much, we know that we have one of these four states, and how much information can we extract from one of these four states? And what's nice is that these four states are actually orthogonal. See, if you take any two rows here, this here is a state, or this here is a state, they're orthogonal. Because the first two rows here are orthogonal because this is minus times plus, it's minus, and plus. So you add up minus, minus, plus, that adds up to 0. These two states are orthogonal. All of them are orthogonal. So they can be distinguished perfectly. There is some basis that will take these four states and map it to the computational state 1, 2, 3, 4. And that's a matrix that does it. You just make it into a matrix. That's a unitary that will take those four states and map it to the computational basis state. So if we apply this unitary, this green box here, after the query, we will get one of the computational basis state out. In this case here, it will be 3 because the one is hidden in envelope number 3. Okay, so this algorithm here is really just a quantum version of the classical randomized algorithm, cleaned up a little bit. Right? If you've just taken an arbitrary classical randomized algorithm and done the obvious thing, namely setting up the superposition of everything in the beginning, you would have discovered this here. Right? There's no creativity to ask for here. Okay, so we can actually solve the computational question of if we have four envelopes here and one is hidden in one of them exactly, then we only need one query quantumly to find it, whereas classically we need 3 queries. Speed up of a factor of 3. Okay. Now let's do the same with free envelopes. Okay, so now I have free envelopes. Okay, so one of them is being negated. If the one is in the first envelope, we pick up a minus here. If the one is in the second envelope, we pick up minus here and so forth. Well, that's sort of sad, because these three states here are not orthogonal. This here is minus, this here is minus, this here is plus. So if you take this state here, inner product with that state here, you get minus 1/3, not zero. So these here cannot be distinguished perfectly. So there's no unitary that will take these three states here and map it to the computational basis state 1, 2, 3. So isn't it sort of ironic that you can take 1 out of 4? If you have 4 envelopes, then you can find the one perfectly. But if you only have 3 envelopes, then you cannot find the one perfectly. It doesn't really make any sense, does it? What are you going to do? Yeah, so one idea is to enlarge the Hilbert space and add a 4th envelope. And then what will you do? What will you put in that 4th envelope?
Zero.
Zero. You have to put zero because you know there is a 1 in one of the other envelopes. So you cannot put a 1. So you take a 4th envelope, put zero in it. This is the unnice solution, the not nice one. Okay, so this is the very intelligent solution. Change the phases somehow. They try to pick up not a minus 1, but a rotation of, say, something less than 1, than minus 1. So this here is not exactly 180 degrees, but it's something less that makes these states orthogonal. Because in some sense, you overdid it here. Oh, no, a very good answer. I didn't even think about it beforehand. So yet another answer. There are many different tricks one can play here to mix it, to fix it. But what I think is that it's a problem about the model. So when you use the phase oracle, you really should allow for non-queries. It's kind of like, this is kind of simulating the 4th envelope. Namely, we will define, and this is just a definition with the model. The model has had an issue. We'll define the model as if it takes zero as the input, and that corresponds to none of the envelopes, then we won't pick up a phase. So whatever amplitude we put in front of this zero here will not pick up a phase. We can drop the amplitude that picks up this phase from 1/3 down to 1/4 by putting a non-query with a zero of 1/4 square root of 1/4 amplitude. So setting up these state here and simply defining the oracle as doing such, then we are fine. So whenever you use the phase oracle, we'll allow ourselves to do these non-queries. And by non-query, I really mean that you don't pick up a phase. You're promised that the phase is zero or plus one. Okay? Exactly. It's only, you have to be learned to appreciate the difference between this, what I'm saying now, and the 4th envelope, because we are really just doing the 4th envelope. But here, I've really changed the model. I've not changed the algorithm. The other approach was more that I changed the algorithm. Here, I've changed the model. There's really no practical difference. But I do want to emphasize this about that when you discuss and consider quantum computing, you really have to validate your model, and I feel this is important. I'm overdoing it a little bit here on purpose. But you're right. Okay, so this is going well. I mean, why don't we do the same? Now let's do binary searching. So this is binary searching among free envelopes. And these three envelopes contain either 0, 0, 1, 0, 1, 1, or all 1, 1, 1. And what you're interested in, what is the position of the leftmost 1? That corresponds to binary searching. It's like looking up a name in a phone book with the promise that you know the name is in that phone book. Right? Because you know that it's one of these cases here. So looking alphabetic, this is the name that you're looking up, and this is the leftmost position that in lexicographically order where the name you're looking up in the phone book sits. Okay. So this problem here, which is really binary searching, where is the leftmost one? So we can do the same as we did before. We set up a query. Maybe we shouldn't use exactly the same amplitudes here, 10 squared of 3, but use something else, so that alpha squared, beta squared, and gamma squared, they add up to 1. Okay, so we set up this superposition here, and then we apply the phase oracle, and we get some superposition out, and we get one of these states out depending on what the oracle is. And notice here, at the last part here, I really allow myself for the non-query. This is the negation of the non-query, because they always pick up a minus 1. Okay. Okay, so what should we pick alpha, beta, and gamma to so that these three states are orthogonal? No, you don't want to answer that. Because they don't exist. It's good. Sorry, that was mean. It's the only pleasure you have in addition to oral exams when you're a prof. So I take great pleasure in that. Sorry. There's no choice of alpha, beta, and gamma here that will make these three states orthogonal. So you cannot search a phone book with three names in one query on a quantum computer. You need two queries. We need 1 point something. Right. So you can ask a couple of questions. Well, how many queries do we really need? Well, if it's discrete, you need two queries. If we can also ask, if you only allowed one query here, what's the best way that you can distinguish these three states here? And then what you want to do is to find a measurement so that these three states here, which have some inner products here, they are sort of being mapped into that computational basis that you measure with respect to and protect in different directions. Okay. So all of this can be solved by just hitting it with math. Okay. So this is a problem which require two queries quantumly and can be solved also with two queries classically. No speed up there. Okay, so this is going well. I mean, we are designing a lot of quantum algorithms here. Let's do one out of n, where n is something different than 3 or 4, maybe. So in this case here, n is big, 7. Okay, we do the same. We set up a superposition of everything. We apply the phase oracle and get some state out. And depending on where the one is, one of these states is being negated. So if the one is in the first envelope, ket 1 is being negated. If the one is in the second envelope, ket 2 is being negated. One of them is being negated, exactly one. Okay, this matrix here, or these vectors here, if you read them horizontally with scalar 10 squared root 7 here, they are not orthogonal, right? So this here will be minus, minus, plus, 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 adds up to 3 pluses. The inner product is 3/7. It's not 0. So they kind of sit like a cone, right? All of the inner products are the same. Okay, so what should we do? I mean, you can just apply this matrix here afterwards and then get 7 orthogonal states out here. Right. But here's a natural thing to try to now do. Let's try to find the best unitary. The unitary, that is the closest to this matrix here, which is not unitary. Right? In some sense, what is the unitary that's the closest to this matrix here, and then apply that unitary? So with respect to what norm do you want to pick it, the unitary? You choose your norm, and then I do it. I have prepared the slide. I know what you're going to guess. So what norm do you pick? You have a matrix. You can't simulate this matrix here. It's not unitary. So we will instead pick a matrix that is unitary, that is as close to the matrix we really wanted to do with respect to some norm, close with respect to some norm. And it doesn't really matter what norm you pick. Oh, okay, I'll let you hang there for a second, guessing what that matrix is while we sort of discuss it a little bit. This matrix here is unitary. This matrix here was too much unitary. And this matrix here is too little unitary. Okay. So here's what you do. No matter really what norm you take with respect to, this is a unitary matrix that's the closest to it. And what you do is that you make the minuses bigger and the pluses smaller. Right, so now you have more minus and less plus, and then you can trade off this here so that the sum is zero. Okay, so this matrix here is unitary. So this is some number here which is big minus, and this is some number which is small plus. And then you can make this matrix here unitary if you make the minuses big enough. Okay, so it doesn't really matter what norm you pick with respect to. This here will be the unitary that's the closest to it. And we'll call that R. And then the one bar, where one means really this state here. One bar means everything. Okay, so that's just a name. Okay, that matrix we will then apply, because that's the unitary that was closest to the matrix we wanted to apply, which we couldn't because it wasn't unitary, sadly. And we get some state out here. So let's analyze what state we get out. Okay, so we set up everything, a superposition of everything. Then we did one query, and then we did the unitary that was the closest to the matrix we wanted to apply. And we get some state out. And the flying one means I've done one query. Sort of like a counter of how many queries have I done so far. Okay. Okay. There is a very sort of succinct way of thinking about these two operators here that we do, Rx and R1. Rx was a query, and it's a phase oracle. The oracle that does nothing when x envelope I contains a 1, plus 1, a plus, no, 0, and it negates the phase when the ith envelope contains a 1. So it's, if xi is 1, then you get 1 minus 2, which is minus 1. So this here is just a diagonal operator with plus and minuses on plus 1 and minus 1 on the diagonal, and you get minus 1 if the ith envelope contains a 1. Okay, and this one was the matrix we defined just before, this matrix here. This matrix is that. And it actually is a reflection. It can be thought of as a reflection. It's the identity minus a reflection about the ray spanned by this state here. And that's why I call it R. And this here is also a reflection. It's a reflection about a subspace, not a ray, not a one-dimensional subspace. Okay. So if you take these two operators here together, then that's a big operator, which we call the green operator or the grower iterate. This is grower's algorithm. This green box here is grower's iterate. We have rederived a rediscovered grower's algorithm by just talking about one query. But just thinking about what can you do with one query we have, and doing the obvious thing all the time, we have rediscovered grower's algorithm. This is it. So let's analyze this green operator, or grower iterate, which is very important. Used a lot of places. Taking two reflection and do something is very important. In fact, one of the only tricks we have in quantum computing, together with Fourier transform and so on, but one can do a lot with it. It's very good to understand it. So that's what you're going to do. Okay, so we have two reflections. This here is a reflection about one state, and this here is a reflection about some other state, phi and psi. And I don't care what phi and psi is. I don't care about the space, the dimension of the space they live in, and so on. They're just some reflection about some states. Okay, so you give them that. Okay. So this operator here, this reflection, it will take phi and map it to minus phi. That's what that does. It takes phi and map it to minus phi, because if you apply this operator here in phi, then the identity gives phi out, and this thing here gives minus 2 phi out. So you have 1 phi minus 2 phi equal minus 1 phi. Right? It takes phi to minus phi. And it takes everything that is orthogonal to phi to itself. Right? If I'm orthogonal to phi, this here gives me identity, and this here gives me nothing. Okay, so it takes phi to minus phi, and everything else to itself. That's a reflection. That's what we call it, a reflection. And this one here does the same with psi. I don't think I should go through it, should I? Okay. So let's say that these two states here are not orthogonal. Right, this is psi, and this here is phi. So I just, they're not orthogonal. They're almost orthogonal here. This angle here is theta, this angle here. Residual angle here is theta. Just some theta. Okay, so let's see what this operator here does on the green state. Okay, so I start with some state, and now I'm going to apply R phi, and then R psi afterwards. Okay, so first I'm going to reflect about phi, and phi was the blue thing. Okay, so I do that. I've reflected about phi. Actually, the complement of phi here. The state that is orthogonal to phi. Okay, I've reflected about phi, let's say. Afterwards, I'm going to reflect about psi. And psi is this ray here. So I take this state here and reflect about psi, and I get this state here out. And then I'll check the negation. So I just take this state here and let it point in the opposite direction and clean up a little bit. So the net effect is that this state has been mapped to that state, and if you do make a very nice drawing, you can see that the angle is exactly 2 theta. So it worked for this state here. Let's pick another state, the orange state, and do the same. So start with the orange state. We reflect about phi and get to the other side. We reflect about psi and get to the other state about psi. And then I'll check the negation, and you get to here, and this angle is exactly 2 theta. So that proves it. I've taken two states that are not parallel and showed what this operator here does in those two states, and this operator here is unitary, therefore I know what it does on everything, namely it rotates by angle 2 theta. So this two reflections is equal to a rotation. So two reflections where you reflect about two states here, which inner product is sine of theta, which is sort of the complement angle is theta, that is equal to a rotation of twice that angle theta. And that's the proof. Questions? Okay. So two reflections equal to a rotation. Why is it so nice to be able to do a rotation? So you let your imagination take you somewhere now. Why is it a good idea to be able to do rotations? In fact, this was used in quantum mechanics for a century. This is about rotations. Right? Rotation about it taking a state. Let's say that you started with this state here, the red state, and you much rather prefer the blue state here, right? You can keep rotating in until the red state becomes the blue state. Right? You're driving the red state here by keeping rotating it up to the blue state. You can take one state and keep rotating it until it becomes your desired state. That's called driving. In quantum mechanics, it's used by quantum physicists much before Grover discovered his algorithm. Or it's used in adiabatic computations, right? This is about slowly driving things. It's used many places before. So we can do a lot of things. We can take a state, map it to another state. That seems to have lots of uses. So let's try to use it. Okay. So let's do Grover's algorithm. In fact, the version I'm going to do is amplitude amplification, an extension of Grover's algorithm. Okay, so here's the question we are going to discuss. Suppose you have an arbitrary algorithm, A, and that algorithm starts on some state, initial state 0, and gives you some superposition psi out. And you're not very happy about psi. If you measure psi, some part of the state solves the problem that you're interested in solving, and some part of the state did not solve the problem. So here there is kind of a, say, a measurement onto some subspace which provides you a solution to the problem, and some subspace which did not provide you a solution to the problem. Okay, so I have some algorithm that solves some problem. I don't really care what they are. And I run the algorithm on a fixed initial state 0. I get some superposition out. If I measure that superposition, I would either solve a problem or not solve a problem. And I put a prime here to indicate that they are not normalized. They're subnormal vectors. And the probability by which my algorithm A solves a problem I was interested in solving, whatever problem that was, is the norm squared of the part of the superposition up here that solved the problem. So this is the probability P by which we solve the problem, the amplitude squared. Okay? So you have an arbitrary problem that solves, that's solved by an arbitrary algorithm A. Okay, so this is a setup. Okay, so we can think of this state here and that state here, the normalized version of these two states are spanning a two-dimensional subspace of the Hilbert space we are acting upon. So there's a two-dimensional subspace which is spanned by psi bad and psi good. And this vector here, psi, that is produced by our algorithm is a superposition within that subspace. And the probability by which we succeed is the projection of red onto blue, this length here squared. Right, that is P. Okay. So now we just define our two reflections, R good and R psi. We reflect about good first, and then we reflect about psi afterwards. And we know already that if you do that on this state, starting with psi initially, what you'll do is that you'll rotate by two theta. We saw that on the previous slide. So if you start with psi, this is psi, so this is the red guy, and you first reflect about blue, and then afterwards red, what you'll do is that you'll drive this state by an angle of two theta closer to psi good. So you'll end up with that state. If I do that again, I'm going to drive it by angle 2 theta, closer to psi good, I'll get up with that state, which is now 5 theta. So 2 theta, 2 theta, and 1 theta is 5 theta. And so forth. If I do it once more, I'll end up with 7 theta. And I could keep going and so on. But now I stop, because now my angle is pretty good, pretty close to psi good. So now I'll stop, and if I stop here, or if I stop there, I'll measure psi good with very high likelihood, because this projection here squared is very large. It's close to 1.
How do you know when
to stop? Exactly. How do I know when to stop? You're ahead of us. So we'll let that hang in the air a little bit and get to that a little bit later. So once you get close to psi good, assuming you know it, then we'll stop, and this vector here will provide something that provides a solution with very high likelihood. And the number of iterations you want to apply to get very close to psi good will be, Well, what is the angle I want to rotate by? Well, it's 2 pi almost. I mean, really, it's 2 pi minus theta, but I'll ignore that. Let's just say that the angle you want to rotate by is pi over 2. Right? You want to take this state here and map it up to here. And each time you rotate by 2 theta. So this is the number of times that you want to rotate. Pi over 2 divided by 2 theta. This number of iteration then, if you take this expression here, well, what is theta? Well, pi over 2 divided by 2, and that's pi over 4, that's about 1, up to a constant. Right? And theta, what is theta? Well, you have sine theta is equal to square root of p. And when theta is small, then sine is really the identity. So you just ignore the sine. So it really just says up here that theta is equal to square root of p. So you just plug in square root of p, and that's it there. So you need to rotate 1 over square root of p times. So after square root of p, 1 over square root of p iterations here of this growth iterate g psi, you measure, you stop, and then you measure, and then you see your solution to your problem that you're interested in with very high likelihood. Okay? This is quadratically better than classically, because classically, if this has been a classical algorithm, and there's nothing that hindered me for having had that to be a classical algorithm initially, had that been a classical algorithm, the number of iteration I would need it would have been 1 over p. Because each time I do my experiment, I have success probability p, so I expect the number of experiments I need to do is 1 over p. So classically, the number of iterations you need to apply is 1 over p, quantumly is 1 over square root of p, a quadratic speedup. This is Grover's algorithm, the extension of Grover's algorithm, considered as amplitude amplification. Okay, questions, comments? So effectively, if you come with a physics background, one could really have rediscovered Grover's algorithm. And in fact, there were physicists that more or less rediscovered Grover's algorithm from these basic physics principles about driving states. Okay. So there is an interesting question in computer science that people are interested in. Namely, it is sort of okay to have a state that is very close to psi good, but there is really a difference to having perfect. I mean, being near perfect and perfect, there's really a big difference whether you're perfect with 99% or 89%. Maybe that's not so significant as being perfect or not perfect. The question is, can you get this state here, the blue state, exactly? Are there ways that we could have gotten this blue state exactly, in theory, at least? Not maybe necessarily in the lab, but in theory. Would that be possible? And so, if so, how could one do it? That we'll call kind of like a quantum version of de-randomization, right? We get rid of the error probabilities. So ideas? I mean, if you do this number of iteration, you get that state. If you get this number of iteration here, you get that state. So you kind of, here you walk too little and here you walk too far. It's kind of like you stopped in Calgary and then you stopped in Edmonton, but you never stopped in Red Deer, which is in between and where you wanted to be, for whatever reason. Suggestions? How do I get to Red Deer?
Sort of average them?
You cannot average them, right? You cannot. And it doesn't make sense. You cannot have a coin that always gives. Yeah. And you cannot subtract the first one from the second either. It's too much classical thinking, but they are good attempts.
Is there some way you can find a vector dipping to reflect over?
Yeah, but this is getting very messy. You can find kind of maybe try to find a vector in between that you can reflect over. So you don't reflect about the blue, but you reflect about something that's slightly less than blue. But reflecting about something slightly less than blue here at maybe the very last step or whatever, somewhere in between or maybe always time, it gets very complicated. So the cleaner solution of it. If you take that a bit step further, then you'll get there. It can be made, it can be done, but it's not pretty. And I'm trying to do things pretty. Okay. Here's a very simple convincing answer. If you started with a state initially that had a less good success probability, then this state here, then you can drop this state here down to this state here. So if you have a state here that is slightly less good and you drop the initial state a little bit, then you can take this state here and rotate it. Then it wouldn't end up here, but it would end up somewhere earlier. So if you just change the initial state and then do the same thing, then you can do that. And it's very easy to change the initial state, because what you do is that you'll do a partial measurement of the initial state to drop the success probability. So you ask with a partial, you'll ask with a query in initial, that's not a complete measurement, but a partial measurement in the initial state, did I succeed or did I not succeed partially? So you drop the success probability here a little bit and you increase the non-success probability a bit. You do an initial partial queries as to did I succeed or not. This is doable. Okay, questions? Yeah, go ahead. Yeah, how do I know phi good in the first place? I was assuming that I know phi good in the first place. So if you know phi good in the first place, if the initial success probability p is known, then we can do this. So thanks for pointing this out. So now we get back to your two questions, and you're both on the same track. What do you do if you don't know the initial success probability?
Before we go further, like,
oops.
If we know phi good, could we not just prepare it? We're trying to drive something to something.
No, you cannot. You cannot just, if you know phi good initially, you cannot just prepare. I mean, it's not that you know phi good. You know the subspace within ellipse, and you don't know what the superposition state here is initially. Here, I'm just doing a partial measurement. That can get me rid of a little bit of the good part. So I kind of project it onto a partial measurements that where part of the measurement is good, and the other part of the measurement is good plus bad. It will be with a partial query, is it in the first envelope or not? With a part of a query.
How do you make a partial query?
Okay, let me continue. Sorry, this is... okay, but these things can be done. And maybe none of them are really very pretty or beautiful solutions. But it's possible to de-randomize if you know P, if you know theta. Okay, so let me keep it at that. Okay, yeah. If you don't know P and you still want to get psi good out here, you don't know theta initially here, you're trying to guess what theta is. But then you don't know theta, you don't know when to stop. Right. But if you stop, imagine that you stop after a random number of iteration, where random is between 0 and infinite. I mean, imagine you could sample from that distribution. So you do between 0 and infinite number of iterations of the grow iterate, and then you stop. Then you'll end up, because these are arbitrary rotations here, you'll end up at a random point on this plane here. You'll have, if you could do random number of iterations, where random is between 0 and infinite, and you really have to go up to infinite, because the initial angle could be arbitrarily small, then you'll end up with a random vector. And if you take a random vector in that vector space here, then its projection onto psi good and psi bad will be 50-50 of a random vector. Right? Because if you have a random vector, there's no difference with respect to what basis you have it. You can pick any basis. So the probability of measuring projecting onto psi good is the same as the probability of projecting onto psi bad, 50-50. Okay, so how do you generate a random vector in finite many iterations here that's fast? Well, the idea is that first you do no grower iterates. You try that. Then afterwards, and then you do that experiment and you measure. And you'll have that state and you measure and you'll probably see psi bad. Then you try one iteration. So you do it all over again. Restart the whole thing classically. Start with zero, generate psi, do one grower iterate. And you measure. And you'll end up with three failure somewhere around here. If that fails, then you try with two. If that fails, then you try with what? Four. And if that fails, you try with eight, exactly. So you go exponentially, right? You double the angle by which each time. So first you try one theta, then you try two theta, and then you try four theta, and then you try eight theta. I mean, if you double each time, you will kind of get close to here. This doesn't exactly work for some reasons. So what you do is that you don't really pick one, two, four, and eight. Each time you pick a random number between one and two, and then a random number between 1 and 4, and then a random number between 1 and 8. And that will work, except you don't go with base 2 here. The exponential growth is not 2, but a constant less than 2. And then it works out. This is called exponential searching, coined by Donald Knuth, well-known computer scientist. This is called exponential searching. This here that you search in the space here doubles each time. Okay. Then you'll actually get close to a vector up here in an expected number of queries here that is 1 over square root of p. And we can still retain the quadratic speed up. So even if you don't know the initial success probability of your algorithm, you can get a quadratic speed up over classical algorithms. You get 1 over square of p instead of 1 over p. Okay. So we are soon going to have a break. And before the break, let's set up the model for the next part of the lectures. Okay. Okay, so now we discussed one query algorithms and growers algorithm. And let's see how far we can push it. Okay, growers algorithm really took the form. I created psi, and then I did a grower iterate, then I did a grower iterate, and so forth. And the last grower iterate over here. And then I measured. That's grower algorithm. In general, any algorithm that uses an oracle will take the form. Well, you can start in some initial known state, say ket 0. And then you do some arbitrary unitary, some unitary of your choice, which is polytime, let's say, if you're interested in time or so. Do some arbitrary initial unitary here that does not depend on your envelopes, your oracle. Okay, so now you have prepared your true initial state here. Then you query the oracle. Then before you do the next oracle, you think about it. Okay, I got that answer out. What do I want to ask for my next query? And it's thinking here's unitary. And you ask your next query, and then you think some more about it, do your third query. Eventually you do your last query, and then you say, oh, now I've done all my queries, now I'm kind of done, and you think about it, what answer you're going to output here after G queries, and then you produce an output. So it's like, you have 20 questions to the professor, if you know that kind of game here. So first you think about what should my first question be, you get an answer, which makes no sense. And think about what should my next question be, and it makes no sense, and so forth. Until I ask 20 questions, and the prof is gone. Right. I mean, these are algorithms. Okay. And after the break, we're going to talk about something else. And that we won't see until after the break.